Thank you for that, Ashley. And thank you to my IFYC colleagues, Becca, Ashley, and Mary Ellen, who've really helped make this happen. And most of all, thank you to our friend Josh Dixon for joining us for what is going to be an enormously powerful and exciting conversation. We're excited about the work that you're doing, Josh. We are excited for you to get to know a little bit about our network, which I understand you've already had some involvement in, and to hear something more of your story. So welcome to the IFYC community for a second or third time. And let's begin with a question that my friend Krista Tippett likes to ask her guests on Being, which is, Josh, tell us a little bit about the religion or spirituality of your childhood. Tell us what you grew up with.
Yeah, thanks so much, Ibu, and thanks, Becca and Ashley, and everyone for having me here. It is a real honor to be here. As you mentioned, I've been involved with IFYC in various capacities over the years, so to be able to have this conversation is a real treat, and I'm very much looking forward to it. In terms of my faith tradition, I was raised in an evangelical Christian household, and that's still the tradition that grounds me today. And I grew up in a family that, went to church twice on Sundays, once on Wednesdays. My dad and his siblings, my dad's parents and my great grandparents all went to Moody Bible Institute. And so we grew up, in kind of a non-denominational evangelical Christian environment, I would say. I think like one of the things that really shaped me in a big way was that my parents have always been deeply committed to service. And so my dad is a teacher in a low-income rural school in upstate New York and has been for a long time because that's his passion. And he loves working with his students. He loves working with the community. He's super involved in a lot of things there. And that was always a really big, or something that really stood out to me, in terms of like seeing faith in action. My mom is a realtor who works with a lot of low-income clients. And so growing up, a lot of times, we would like on a Wednesday night after sports practice, we would go and work on helping some of her clients get their homes ready to sell. We would clean houses, we would paint houses, we would, and she did it all free of charge because she was, just someone who was like, my job is to serve people. Right. And that's kind of how she saw her vocation. And so for me, so much of my faith journey has been rooted in this idea of service. Even back when I was in middle school, I remember I got in some trouble for some things. My parents were like, we really want to like bring you back to the values that we think are important. So we started going and like volunteering at the Open Door Mission in upstate New York, which is a homeless shelter, a faith-based homeless shelter. And just being able to like work and volunteer there with the staff and get to know some of the folks who came in regularly, I think was pretty formative for me. And then service was a big part of my time in high school too. And that was really a way that I saw my faith playing out. And when I got to college, I went to the University of Michigan, and I was really involved with Campus Crusade for Christ. And, because again, like my faith has been and continues to be the most important thing in my life. And when I was in CRU, a lot of our focus was on outreach, connecting with people, bringing people into our events and whatnot. Then after CRU, after college, I think like one of the things that really stood out to me about the opportunity that I had to go to a four-year college and university was that so few people in the world have that chance. And this question of, how are you going to use the opportunities you've been given to open the doors of opportunity for other people really kind of stood out in my mind, right? It's like that ages-old adage, like to whom much is given, much is required. And I thought I had the opportunity to get a high school education, to get a college education. What can I do with that in a way that I think really aims to live into that ethic of service that, again, is so important to my Christian faith, right? Like I have this Bible verse written, actually painted on my dorm room wall, which was, Mark chapter 10, verse 45. And it was like, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. And I think, that has just been a real guiding sort of ethos for my own journey. And so that was a big reason why after college, I chose instead of, I was thinking about a lot of the traditional paths, right? Law school, business, other things like that, especially a lot of things that in Michigan that people are encouraged to do. But what really stood out to me was, going and doing a national service program. And so I went and taught in the South Side of Chicago with Teach for America. And I think that was a very formative experience as well. And really, I think really was where I found my calling to jump into service for the rest of my career too, and to see my faith play out there. So in short, you know, I think that's really my own faith journey has really been rooted in this ethic of service, because that's how I see the ministry of Jesus playing out, you know, and I think that I've seen that play out in different ways across my own journey. That's the reason why I'm doing the job that I'm doing now, is because, you know, I deeply believe that we are in this consequential moment for the history of our country, that will determine which direction we bend the arc of the moral universe. And I think, you know, a part of my own commitment to service is working towards a mission that I believe is trying to bend that arc in the right direction. And so that's just kind of really been a big undergirding part of my own story. And I go to a non-denominational church here in Denver, where I live right now. It's called Denver Community Church, and that's still a big part of my own kind of faith journey and walk, and very much informs a lot of my own professional journey as well.
Yeah, thank you for that. IFYC's first formal office when we moved out of the trunk of my 1996 Chrysler Cirrus was in the LaSalle Street Church building, which was right down the street from the Moody Bible Institute. Yep. And I remember I would go to a coffee shop next to the building and hang out with these Moody students. I love those conversations about faith. And we have a cherished member of our staff, Rob, who's a grad student right now at Moody. So we, you know, it has been my experience that faith and service are not only so connected in the life of myself as a Muslim from the Ismaili community, but so much of my work has been done in Christian communities that connected faith and service. And I'm curious, Josh, to that, I'm wondering when religious diversity kind of enters your life and how, and how formative or formational is that when you begin to realize the religiously diverse nature that is the United States and the world?
Yeah, absolutely, Ibu. So for me, I think, you know, I grew up in upstate New York, a little town right outside of Rochester, was not very diverse. When I was in college, the University of Michigan is pretty diverse. I would say like the circles that I was involved with were not as diverse. So for me, a lot of it came when I was when I took that job as a teacher in the South Side of Chicago. And my classroom was, two thirds of my students were Latinx and one third were African American. And that was also around the time when I got involved with a community organizing group, the Industrial Areas Foundation. And that was around the time also that I learned about IFYC after being involved with the IF for a couple of years. Through the IF, I think like that was really where it was very serendipitous. I read The Audacity of Hope by Barack Obama over the holiday break my first year as a teacher. And that was right around 06 to 07, right? Like the new year coming into 07. And I literally came back to Chicago and went to a birthday party of a friend of a friend. And I had never heard of a community organizer until I read Barack Obama's book. And at that birthday party was a community organizer. And actually, I think you know him. His name's Tim King. We started talking, and I was like, yeah, I was just reading about community organizing in this book. And he was like, well, you should like come to some of our meetings. You know, you're a teacher. We need more young voices and folks who are involved in the community. So just started showing up and met a lot of people from a lot of different backgrounds, and it really got kind of like, I think, grounded in that idea of, hey, despite a lot of differences, like differences are our strength. Right. And like, we can really like, in spite of differences, like we can work to find kind of common ground, shared values, and actually like work to understand and get to know each other's differences, because they're a really beautiful thing. That was really, I think, where I got deeply exposed to people from a lot of different perspectives, where people were like in my face, like questioning, like, why do you believe this? Why do you believe this? And, you know, while it may have been uncomfortable at times, it was also, I think, really growth inducing and really helpful for me to come into my own in terms of what I did believe and the way in which my faith shaped me, but also in which how I really got to understand and appreciate other people's faiths and their perspectives and the things that drove them, you know, into things that we had in common, and things that, you know, we were working on together. We worked a lot on some big issues like school funding reform, and brought a really diverse coalition of like young leaders from across the city around that. We worked a lot on young adult ex-offender job training programs. We worked a lot on youth homelessness. And I mean, I think for me, it really just showed like the beauty of faith-motivated people coming together around a common cause, and how powerful the collective voice of groups like that can be. And we saw like how resonant it was with legislators who we would go talk to. We saw how resonant it was with, you know, city officials and people who we worked with at Chicago Public Schools and across the board. And so, you know, I think that was really where I was able to get a lot of experience working with folks from diverse backgrounds, and really get to know people and get to know their perspectives in ways that I think have helped shape my career path moving forward, but also have helped, I think, like broaden the reach of the work that I've been able to do, and helped me meet a lot of my closest friends. I mean, like for example, I attended an IFYC conference, I think it was in 2010, at Northwestern. And I actually, like, I remember going to the conference, meeting a whole bunch of IFYC staff, and then meeting some folks who were currently working in the Obama administration. And we struck up a conversation, and we actually ended up all going out to dinner together that night. I remember exactly where it was, in Chicago. And that actually led to a lot of those folks becoming some of my closest friends. That actually led to, I think, like some of the professional opportunities that I've had since then were like very much a result of some of those relationships, right? And I think it just goes to show, stepping up, stepping in, just like exploring the ways that folks, that you can work together with people, get to know people better. Like, you never know where it's gonna lead. And I think for me, building those relationships and trying to lean in there has really been a big part of my own journey as well.
Yeah, I got to tell you, Josh, like this is, you know, we're coming onto the 20th year of IFYC as a formal nonprofit organization. And you're kind of bringing me back to the original vision, right? Which is, yeah, which is very much somebody recognizing how their own faith or philosophical commitment inspires service, and how it's not just abstract, but it's actually manifest in all these different organizations and all these different modes. And then realizing that other faiths and philosophical convictions have the same relationship between faith commitment or philosophical commitment and service, and asking themselves, well, you know, can I do this horizontally, right? And so you're basically telling that story that you had this powerful experience in your own life as an evangelical Christian, yeah, coming up in New York State and at the University of Michigan. It manifests in going to work at Teach for America and being a part of the Industrial Areas Foundation, right? And then you're, yeah, saying, oh, wow, and then I'm meeting these Jews and these Muslims and these secular humanists and these Catholics who have the same kind of faith and service conviction. And you're asking the question, well, what can we do together? Right. And those, yep, early years of like community organizing reform that you're talking about, you know, that is so much the original vision of IFYC back when it was, you know, the idea hit in 1998 and we built it starting in 2002. And, yeah, and you're one of thousands and thousands and thousands of people who have seen that in your own life and been affected, yeah, in some way by IFYC's work. So it's powerful to hear.
Yeah. And you know, I worked with a number of IFYC alums in the Obama administration when I eventually ended up there, in between 2013 and 2015. I still work with a lot of folks who I either met through IFYC or who I had a chance to work more closely with through some of the interfaith campus service challenge projects that were going on through the White House Office of Faith-Based Neighborhood Partnerships. And so I think that like one of the cool things that I have always, or one of the things I've always deeply appreciated about IFYC is like the deeply relational elements of it, and the ways in which, you know, IFYC is not about networking, it's about relationship building. And I think that like relationship building is so foundational for a lot of things, not just for friendships, but also for, you know, the ways that you can live out your purpose and your meaning in like vocationally or as a volunteer or however it may play out. And I think that, you know, for me, I've just seen that happen in very real, tangible ways from a lot of my experiences with folks who I met from IFYC. So, it holds a really special place in my heart for all those reasons, as well as all of the awesome work that I have seen y'all do over the years.
Yeah, thank you for that. It is very moving to hear. So we have lots and lots of people on this webinar who are asking themselves the question, how do I do the kind of work that Josh Dixon does, right? So both students and alum and also educators who are saying, how do I help my facilitate my students to do this kind of work? So Josh, tell us about what your professional life looks like since joining the Biden campaign. What do you do on kind of a day-to-day or week-to-week basis?
Yeah, absolutely. So as National Faith Engagement Director for the Biden team, my work kind of cuts across a number of different strategic priorities. I will say that we have a few sort of anchoring principles that we try to take into all of our work on this campaign in particular, because I've been fortunate to work on several campaigns. My first campaign job was on the Obama campaign in 2012. I first worked at the DNC as the Deputy Director of Faith Outreach, and then was out in Ohio leading Faith Outreach there for the last couple months of the campaign. And then have been involved in different capacities in campaigns since then, though much of my professional career has been in the public service space. But there are, I've learned a bunch along the way about things that are important and have made a lot of mistakes along the way. And so have learned from those as well. And I think that has kind of led to sort of the vision for our work in faith engagement on this campaign. And I think, like, on the whole, we are working to build the most robust, diverse, inclusive coalition of faith-motivated leaders, community members, and groups as a part of this campaign that any presidential campaign has ever seen. That's our goal, is to really, really work to ensure that we are building a movement of people who are going to be a part of restoring the soul of our nation. The vice president talks about that. He started his campaign from a moral framework and really aiming to bring us in a direction that I think leans into who we are at our best in this country. When we're really, I think, anchored in those values of loving our neighbors, ourselves, of being our brothers and sisters keepers, working to ensure that everyone has the chance to reach their God-given potential, of like caring for the poor and marginalized, and working to sweep down walls of oppression and injustice. And so our goal on faith engagement is really how do we bring people in as much as possible? How do we listen as much as possible? How do we seek to understand, operate with grace, build relationships so that not only, obviously, we have a goal of winning the election, but how can we build a coalition that can really work together in a Biden-Harris administration at a time when our country faces so many challenges on so many fronts, right? Which I know that people of faith and faith leaders are really bearing the weight of in a lot of ways as people on the front lines. And so for us, we have these three anchoring principles, right, that kind of align with this. The first is we want to ensure that people of faith feel valued and respected by this campaign. Deeply important for us. And we want to be explicit about that and explicitly call that out. Because sometimes that doesn't happen in campaigns. And we want to make sure that it's very much known that people of faith are really, really important to this ticket. They're very important to the vice president as someone who is a man of faith and has been shaped by his faith. Same thing with Senator Harris. She talked about that at the debate last week. The second anchoring principle is we are directly asking for the support of people of faith. Too often, some faith communities are taken for granted. Some faith communities are neglected. For us, we are directly trying to court faith-motivated voters and make the argument that our ticket is a clear moral choice in this election. And then third is we are working to show people why the values of the Biden-Harris agenda align much more with the common good values of people of faith in the current administration, rather than just saying, we're not Donald Trump. So for us, it's really making a positive case for the vice president and Senator Harris. And so those are kind of three anchoring principles that we operate with. And then in terms of my work, it really falls across six different key buckets. So the first is getting our message out there. And we do this through leader, like faith leader engagement. We do this through different earned media opportunities. We're actually doing paid ads highlighting the vice president's faith, which you don't often see in presidential campaigns. We also do this in a really integrated way throughout the campaign. For folks who tuned into our convention, you saw faith woven in throughout. The vice president talked about it. Senator Coons gave a primetime speech on the vice president's faith during the night of the vice president's acceptance speech. That doesn't often happen, but this is something that we are deeply leaning into because we know that it's especially important in this moment when our country is facing all these challenges. The second big thing we're doing is working to provide opportunities for direct engagement. So we want anyone to be able to directly get involved with us. We run multiple events every week. We do a lot of virtual ways for people to tune in to Believers for Biden events, to tune into faith-specific events. We have Muslims for Biden. We have Jewish Americans for Biden. We have Catholics for Biden. We have Evangelicals for Biden. We have AAPI Christians for Biden. We have Creyentes con Biden, our Latino Believers program. We have a number of different spaces, Latter-day Saints for Biden. And so across the board, we've had folks kind of involved in these different groups and really in a grassroots way, coming together to create spaces for their different different communities to be a part of supporting this ticket and getting involved. We also provide opportunities for folks to attend, phone banks and text banks and get involved with states and do house parties and things along those lines. The third thing that we do is nonpartisan voter education. And so we work with a lot of congregations just to provide, things, resources, information, especially with, the pandemic. There are so many questions about how to vote, the ways to vote, how to register, how to get a ballot. So we work with a lot of different community leaders to get that information out there. Fourth is we work specifically to engage faith leaders because we know that their perspectives are so important. And the first thing that I did when I started this campaign was set up listening sessions. And just as many listening sessions as possible. Did listening sessions with the Latter-day Saint community, the AAPI Christian community, the Latinx faith leader community, the humanist community, the evangelical community, the Catholic community, and many more. And those are closed, off the record listening sessions with leaders where you just had a chance to hear what are the issues that are important to you? What's important to your community right now? What are some of the challenges y'all are facing? What's feedback that you have for us? No real agenda for those other than to listen and to build relationships, and sure, did some of those folks end up letting us know later, hey, we want to support your ticket? Absolutely. Not everyone did because it was a broad cross-section of people, but I think like that's how we're going to be able to move forward. And that's how we're going to be able, if we win, to govern in an inclusive way, is by having that relational fabric built in advance. And so those listening sessions have been really helpful and instructive for informing our programming, for informing the ways in which we are working with different communities now, but even more so the way that we would work with a broad, robust, diverse group in a Biden-Harris administration. But then we also involve and try to amplify leader voices in a lot of different ways, whether it's through op-eds, it's through involving them in our different events. We also have I mentioned this before, but our strategies were integrated. So you see faith integrated in our Latino program. You see it integrated in our African-American program. You see it integrated in our women's program. You see it integrated in our LGBTQ programming. So across the board, we know that faith cuts across all of our different coalitions. And so we really, really work to amplify faith voices as much as possible in as many places as possible. The fifth thing is policy. And that's really where we try to lean in and highlight a lot of the common good policies that we have, such as our racial equity policy, our anti-human trafficking policy, our Lift Every Voice for Black Americans policy, our Latino agenda, our immigration policy, our COVID response policy, our refugees policy, and more. And so we really try to, some of those were policies that were actually being formed and shaped when I came on the campaign. And so, part of my job is like, listening, hearing people out, getting input on those, and ensuring that, you know, the plans and proposals we're putting forward are really driven by members of impacted communities. And then the sixth thing is just working with our battleground states, because we know that elections are won in the states. And so, that's where actually for the next 3 weeks, I'll be spending a lot of my time is really working with our battleground states and supporting their work to engage people on the ground, supporting their work to get out the vote, supporting their virtual events, their rallies, their communications, and things like that. So hopefully that's helpful for folks in terms of giving a bit of a rundown, a little bit of background, a little bit of our philosophy and how we approach this. But I think, you know, we have an historic opportunity right now. We are in this historic moral moment as a country, I think. And I think that there are so many key indicators of that. Going back to Charlottesville, but since then, we have just had all of these different really important things happen that really are, I think, that stand out to people as key markers that beg the question, how will we respond to this? How will we respond to this challenge? How will we respond to George Floyd? How will we respond, you know, to so much of the injustices that we see in our country right now? And so I think that question of how will we respond is really on the ballot. And, you know, for us, we are working hard every single day to talk about the ways in which we think our ticket is a clear moral choice in this election.
Yeah, that's powerful. And I, you know, it's striking to hear you talk about your formation and your commitment to the relationship between your faith and service and how you see that across lines of diversity. And now your faith and in policy and politics. And one of the things that you said to our friend Simranjeet Singh was that systemic racism is not only amongst the biggest policy issues of our time and of American history, but also it's the key religious issue of this election. And I want to put that in conversation with something that Elaine Krebs, a member of the IFYC family, asked in the Q&A, which is, you know, which policy issues ought we bring our faith to? And which ones should we say our faith should not have a role in this? And it's kind of a complex and fraught conversation in American life.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. These things are really complicated. And I think that, the first step here is always just awareness and like really diving in and being open to talking about things, especially with people who have different opinions and perspectives than you. I think when I was younger, it's like, you don't know what you don't know. And I think for me, one of the things that I've learned now being 36 and not being 22 is how important it is to talk with people who have different perspectives, because it will help shape you. It will humble you, and it will teach you how important it is to always try to seek other perspectives, because you're always going to miss something. Right? Like, you only have so much in terms of what you're bringing to the table. I think on this particular question, like, I'll answer it for me. I think for me, my faith informs my values. My faith informs, you know, the things that I think are these like core foundational principles. And I think the values are really what I bring to policy. These values, you know, and I was talking about these a little bit earlier in terms of the things that I think stand out to me about this ticket. And one of the reasons why I wanted to jump back in and get involved in this election, even though elections are grueling. And I remember after my last campaign, I was like, I don't know if I can do this again. You know, it's so much hard work, but, this is such a crucial election and campaign. And so for me, I was really compelled by the values that come from my faith to get involved in this, because I think that so many of those values are both at stake in terms of the ways in which the candidates operate and the things that anchor them and really drive their decision-making. But also, I think that the values that are so important to me play out in the policy arena too. And I think, you know, to what you were saying earlier, Ibu, about systemic racism, I mean, that is, I deeply believe that systemic racism is the real religious issue of this election. I think our country is in a time of critical and important reckoning around this original sin. I think that it's deeply important that we have leadership that is going to bring us forward, that is going to address this and bring us forward out of so many of the challenges we're dealing with now in a way that is focused on healing, transformation, reconciliation, and redemption. And I think that having those things woven into the approach on an issue like this is deeply important. And those things all come from my faith. But those are all values that come from my faith on this particular issue. I think there are other issues as well, you know, where the values that come from my faith, you know, really inform my perspective and where I stand on things. I also think, you know, we live in a pluralistic society. And so, you know, I think you write about this a lot in your first book. I remember when I read Acts of Faith, and it's super inspiring for me, you know, when I was 23 years old, teaching on the South Side of Chicago, you know, just about like learning about religious pluralism and like, how do we work together to anchor in like shared values that drive us towards a vision of hope, right? And so I think we also need to take that into consideration. And that's actually why I think it's so important right now that we're working to build all these relationships in a broad, diverse way, so that hopefully when there is a Biden-Harris administration, we're bringing people together who we've already had a chance to get to know and to establish trust with, so that we can work collaboratively in a pluralistic society to do, you know, things on the policy front that are really going to bend that arc of the moral universe in the direction of justice. So I think that's how I approach it, you know, from my own personal standpoint. And I think that's actually what I look for in candidates and in causes that I support too, is like, where are those core values really clear and aligned with what I share? Because I think like those things anchor so much around decision-making in general. And they anchor so much about how someone is going to lead, which will deeply impact the ways in which we see their leadership play out.
Yeah. Thank you for that. You know, we have such smart questions from our network coming in, and I'm just going to combine a couple of those for you. And some of the questions are about diversity, right? And mm-hmm. and different valences of diversity. And so I want to ask something of a two-part question. And the first part is from Victoria McKeon, who says, you know, the United States, diversity can lead to division. Mm. Right. And right now is a time of a ton of division. And how can you help diversity move towards cooperation rather than division? So that's part one of the question. And part two is from Amelie Zinn, who says, you know, who points out that not everybody is able to bring their faith to the table in as robust a way as for example, Vice President Biden. So, you know, I think, you know, when my friend Keith Ellison became the first Muslim congressperson, one of the first questions he's asked on a national media show is prove to me that you're not working for our enemies, right? Mm-hmm. Yep. It's just straight up bigotry, right? Yep. So how have you seen that, Josh, in the campaign and in your life as a community organizer, the way that some identities they're suspect and other identities are welcome? That's a dimension of diversity, those power differentials. And then back to Victoria's part of the question, which is, what do we do to nurture diversity towards cooperation rather than allow it to descend into division?
Yeah, these are great, great questions, Ibu, and appreciate the folks who raised them. I think that, you know, like starting on the second point, you know, I think we live in such a diverse country, right? We have 340, 350 million people in this country, 50 states, other territories, you know, diversity within states, a lot of different communities. And with that, you know, comes a lot of difference. And I think we've seen this throughout the history of the United States, where it's very easy, I think, when there are differences, for folks to, you know, stick to what they know. And I think it's easy when you don't know other people and you don't know about them and you haven't had a chance to get to know them. I think sometimes folks can come to conclusions or make assumptions and things like that. Just like what you were talking about in referencing Attorney General Ellison. And you know, I'm really thankful that he's been able to be successful in what he's done. But you know, you're right. There are definitely barriers and stigmas and stereotypes that are incredibly unfair. I mean, we see these things play out right now in our public policy. We see these things exacerbated by the current administration. be it the way that they talk about different communities, be it the way that they race bait, be it the way that, you know, whether it's the Chinese virus or it's the Muslim ban or things like that. I think that, you know, these things have been present in our country. They're present in a lot of countries. And I think that they are realities and they are a dynamic that it's going to be up to us to continue to fight against and address. I think that it's really, really important that we work to actively address a lot of these stereotypes in our own private lives, in our public lives, and that we are doing everything we can. I think a lot of it comes, a lot of what I've seen BD like help break down barriers and walls along these lines, you know, is representation in key places, is inclusion, is a seat at the table in key places. I think that, you know, the fact that Senator Kamala Harris is a woman of color, and that's historic, I think is an example of that, on a presidential ticket, from our end. But I think also, you know, seeing, the diversity of President Obama's cabinet, and how much that stood out and how much so many of those appointments meant to different communities, right? Seeing people who were able to, you know, like really lean into their leadership from a diverse array of perspectives. So I think that's really, really important. And that's the thing that needs to be a priority for us. I think also when it comes to the question around the first question, I think so much of that starts in relationship. And I think so much of it starts with, you know, taking the posture of not making assumptions about people, taking the posture of seeking to understand people, taking the posture of like really embracing the concept of grace across the board. I think that that's so important. You know, I come from a cross-cultural family in terms of my wife and my in-laws are from Hong Kong and my wife is from Houston. I'm from upstate New York and my family's originally from Ireland and Scotland, you know, and so there are a lot of differences that we navigate there, you know, and I think a lot of it comes down so much to really trying to take the time to build relationships and to seek to understand other people. And I think like intentionally building relationships outside of your comfort zone and immersing yourself in diverse environments is absolutely one of the things that I think that I recommend to everyone who's really trying to be a bridge builder. I think that if anybody wants to get involved in community organizing, if anybody wants to get involved in politics, these are deeply important experiences to have. And I think they really shape you in ways that you can't even anticipate. They shape you in ways that books can't. I think books are deeply important. I encourage everyone, you know, to read perspectives outside your comfort zone as much as you can as well. But I think that simply, you know, acts in a symbiotic way with the real relationship building. I also think that during COVID, you know, and so much of the, we've done this social distancing, which I think has led to a lot of social isolation. It's like so many of our relationships are on screens and are digital. And so I think that, you know, there in those spaces, it's especially important to operate in a way of, you know, giving people the benefit of the doubt and of, you know, trying to have conversations with people because, yeah, it can be easy just to not understand the complexity of what's happening with people and where they're coming from in these types of environments. So those are some of the things that I've just seen in my own walk, my own journey, that are really important. I know that, you know, in the one of the things that I've always appreciated about Vice President Biden is that I think he's someone who displays deep empathy. He's someone who has a reputation as someone who wants to ask questions, wants to know who you are. I had a friend who was at an event with him last night, and my friend called me and said, yeah, I told him about my I think it was his niece, who is Indian American, and that she said that she was afraid that if President Trump wins a second term, she'll get deported. And the vice president said, I want to call her right now. Can I call her right now? You know, and I think that like that type of leadership stands out. It's like someone who's willing to like get in the trenches, get to know real people, talk to real people, and really understand where they're coming from, and meet them where they're at. And I think, you know, his commitment to a diverse cabinet has said a lot to me. And you know, that's, these are all things that I think come from the values that drive people as leaders, right? Like just going back to those values. And those are the you see those foundational values play out in consistent ways. Whether those are values you agree with in certain cases, like for me, you know, it's why I support Vice President Biden and Senator Harris. But you know, you see when there are other values at play, you see how they play out too. And you know, I think that the current administration is an example of that from my vantage point. So yeah, I think great questions. And I know that we're getting close to time here, so I'll turn it back to you. But.
No, so thank you. So I, you know, I want to say that what I'm hearing, right, is Josh, it's basically diversity mixed with relationship is what facilitates cooperation, which kind of sounds obvious, but actually relationships are not easy. And as you made the distinction, it's not networking. There's something holy about relationships, right? Totally. And and you see the manifestations of this in so many of our faith traditions. The way the sages and prophets of our traditions were with people. We're with people, the manner, and you know, you are with other people. So you know, I want to mention to the folks who are part of this webinar that IFYC is going to be inviting a range of responses from our network, which is religiously and ideologically diverse, to what Josh has been saying. And we have a great platform for that called Interfaith America. Just go to ifyc.org/interfaithamerica, and there'll be a range of written responses. And we encourage you to reach out and write something yourself. So with our last 30 seconds, Josh, a question from Lauren, who is a fellow Michigan grad. As a Notre Dame fan, it's hard to deal with so many Michigan grads, but in 30 seconds, what's one thing you did as an undergrad that prepared you for the role that you're in now? And then we'll have to bid you goodbye.
Yeah. I mean, I think, getting to know as many people as possible. A big part of my campus ministry was just getting to know, like trying to get to know everybody in my dorm. I like literally had I took a job in the cafeteria to make a little bit of extra cash, but also because like as a food server, you just get to talk to people all the time. You know, and for me, a lot of it was like ministry focused, but it was really like helpful in terms of, you know, building that muscle for relationship building. And so I think as much as possible, get involved with different things, but really try to build as many relationships as possible. Get to know people, immerse yourself in diverse perspectives. You will only be better for it.
We appreciate you, Josh. We thank you for the work that you're doing, and it is intense. It's hyper intense. This is probably, you know, like the first third of your 14-hour day. We're grateful to you for that. And we're grateful to you for reminding us about the holiness of relationship and also that it's a skill and it takes work. So thank you for who you are. We'll bring you back in a couple of minutes for an intimate circle with just a handful of our alum. And thank you for being a part of our day, Josh. And thank you for the work that you're doing.
Thanks so much, Ibo. Thanks for the work you all do. Thank you, Becca, Ashley, and everyone. Appreciate you tuning in and look forward to staying in touch.